What's up, nerds? Welcome to episode 8 of The Bandwagon Fan. This is the show where we talk all things pop culture.
I'm Alex.
I'm AJ.
And I'm Josh. Let's start nerding out together by checking out some of the latest news. And gents, the first thing, how are you?
Alex is, Alex, you can go first.
Do we really want to tell everyone? Yes, no, I'm better. I've had the stomach flu for the past few days. But today is a new day and I feel much better. I managed to walk about a quarter of a mile and eat half a cup of rice. And
hey,
you know, I'm getting there.
So
I would recommend the rice diet. It's really good for you.
You're pulling through for our listeners is what I'm hearing.
Yeah, I literally got out of bed to pull through for the listeners.
What kind of rice? Was it minute rice or did you make your own rice?
I at least made it. I can't do instant rice. Like, okay. I got jasmine rice.
Yeah, it's good rice.
Ever since I learned how to make rice, unfortunately late in my life, I think it was college, but it was late, you know, but I can't eat instant rice anymore. It's just disgusting.
For any of our listeners, were you gonna say, Josh?
Go ahead.
I was gonna say, for any of our listeners, invest in a good rice cooker. I promise you.
Oh, for sure.
You'll thank me later.
Okay? I don't have one, but I want one.
Oh, it's worth it. In one,
I cook a lot of rice.
Skip the whole boiling tactic.
Yeah, the boiling thing. That's days of futures past. Okay, like we're in the future now, and you gotta use a rice cooker, bro.
And don't measure your rice. You got to do it traditional style. You just pour some water in there. Yeah, you dip your finger in there, eyeball it.
Yeah,
this is the only way to do it.
Josh, that's going to be a Christmas gift. That's going to be your Christmas gift, a rice cooker.
Rice cooker? All right. Yeah. Or if any listener wants to get me one too, I'd be fine with that.
Oh, yeah, that too. Yeah. We take donuts.
All this is, if you're listening, don't feel guilty at all that Alex is sick, but he's still recording. So maybe you should listen to the end. Just saying.
Oh, yeah. See.
But we're glad you're here, Alex. AJ, how you doing?
I'm great, man. I'm great. Yeah. I'm awake. I'm here. I'm alive.
From the tacos you ate, right?
Yeah, from the tacos. Made some birria tacos earlier. Nice. I feel bad for all my people in the Midwest and the East Coast. You guys are going through a snowstorm. Hashtag can't relate.
Yeah,
can't relate to that.
I'm dealing with 3-foot waves from a supposed tsunami that's gonna hit LA.
It's so crazy. I was just watching a TikTok about these guys in Australia. They're like watching the news, seeing about the tsunami, and then they go outside and ride the waves. I'm like, these people are crazy.
Yeah, I'm not doing that, but like, thankfully the waves have been very, very, very small here.
well, glad you guys are both all right. I'm the same as you, AJ. I'm here, trying to stay healthy. Hopefully, if you're listening, you're staying healthy too.
Yeah,
let's take care of ourselves and each other in this new year.
It's 2022. Stay healthy and stay sexy. That's
and hydrated.
And hydrated.
I can never not do the second one. The third one's optional, though.
Right.
Yeah.
But going into the news of pop culture, did you guys hear what happened at Image Comics?
No. I heard a little bit, but not a lot.
So what some of you may not know is most comic book companies do not have unions. So if you work for DC or you work for Marvel, we talked about this in our C2E2 episode. Mm-hmm. A lot of times you're not even an employee. You're just considered work for hire. Image Comics is the first comic company where they formed a union. And what's very unique about them is Image creators are employees. You own all of your stuff.
So I learned recently that some people don't know what a union is. So do you want to explain?
Really?
Yes. I was explaining this to someone. They didn't really understand what a union was. So explain to our listeners, what exactly is a union? Like, how does it work?
Wow. That's like explaining like what's air.
Anyway, it is weird, but
it is.
But
it makes, so all those things, it's like it I take sense. For granted.
Yeah.
Okay. So union is, it's a group that will represent your interest at your workplace. It's probably the simplest way I could put it.
Right.
And people have different views on if unions are good or bad. You know, it's been a long time debate, especially like in the U.S. Like unions were seen as kind of like villainous when in fact they were fighting for workers' rights. Fast forward, and that's, in my opinion, it's changed a little bit, but overall I do see the value in them. And so at Image, again, creators aren't employees. You own your work and Image just distributes for you. I believe Image only has about 18 employees. And out of those employees, very recently, a few of them, I believe it was 9, were eligible to vote on if they wanted to unionize or not. And it did pass. So they created, it's going to be called the Comic Book Writers United. You can Google them, go to their website, see their goals and their purpose and all that stuff. And so my thoughts on this are, will this impact the industry as a whole? And if it is it going to benefit or hurt creators? Because right now, Image creators aren't going to benefit from this. It's just the people who are working.
Just the people who work directly.
Yeah, I can't tell what the benefit is for the creators at all. That's what I've been confused with. Is I feel like it should have been a union with the writers, but I just wonder what kind of deals these creators have with Image.
I wondered that too.
That's one thing I think would be kind of fun to dive into, maybe on another episode someday.
Yeah, I'd love to have somebody from Image sometime come talk to us about that stuff. And in regards to forming a writers union, you, especially like with Marvel or DC, they actually can't do that because of antitrust laws from, I believe, 1946. It would be considered, can't think of the word, like having a monopoly on the industry where you are altogether setting the page rates or whatnot. And so because a lot of weird red legal tape, a lot of these big companies, the creators actually can't unionize. You can do something like a guild, like the Writers Guild of America, but that has yet to be done. Back in like the 70s and 80s, a few creators tried to do that. But again, it's just like this weird legal red tape. So it'll be interesting to see if this has any effects down the road.
I think it has some potential. I think it helps that a company like Image is doing this compared to like another independent. Like, I love Aftershock, but I feel like they're not, you know, like quite as big of a comic company. Like, I feel like Image is slowly catching up with like DC and Marvel in the sense that they have series that are already TV shows, and I think series that are becoming future TV shows, you know, like The Walking Dead. And I'm sure they would do something with East of West at some point.
Right.
But yeah, so I'm curious if that like does help with the other indie comic companies.
And for those of you who don't know, Image is an independent publisher for comics. They have done, like Alex said, The Walking Dead, East of West.
And Spawn, right? Wasn't that like their big one in the 90s?
Yeah, Spawn. Yeah. Who has kind of made a comeback recently in recent years. But yeah, versus like Marvel and DC, people are a little bit more familiar with those. But Image is considered independent, and they are known for some of those titles, though. Do any of you guys watch anything on Peacock?
What?
I do not.
I'm just kidding. Peacock. It's, okay. The worst streaming name ever. I'm like, what? The Peacock?
I don't watch it.
Are we going to call it the P? We can't call it the other thing.
Yeah, what are you watching it on the P?
On the P, yeah. What's on the P, man?
Well, they have a new show that's gonna be coming out.
What's on the tip of the P?
Yes, tell us what's on the tip, please.
Will Smith.
Will Smith's on the tip.
Is going to be a co-producer on a show called Bel Air.
Oh, yeah. I saw the trailer for that. I thought it was... I had a really good debate with another coworker. And I think it's going to be... I think it's a good idea. I think it's cool. I almost feel like it's an homage to the actor. I can't remember who played the original Uncle Phil. But if you guys know anything about like the behind-the-scenes type of stuff, he was like a very prominent like Shakespearean actor. And so he, James Avery, that's his name. He was a very prominent, Shakespearean actor. And, you know, he kind of brought this level of I don't want to say seriousness, but this importance, this reverence
gravitas
to that. To the role. So I almost feel like it's an homage to him in a weird way. Okay. I feel like Will Smith really had this so that it's not, I don't want to say like dramatic, but serious, right? Because
well, it is going to be a drama. It looks like it's
right. Very cool, but yeah, it's a drama, like a drama, but not dramatic. You know right. what I mean? Like yeah. like shows like Power are dramatic, right? And yeah. so like there's this layer of relatability I think that they're trying to bring to it because the original Fresh Prince was a little bit, you know, kitschy, a little bit, you know, I mean, it was a comedy, right? So it was always kind of just like, you know, Will Smith looking into the camera and like saying something sometimes, breaking the fourth wall. So I think this will work. I think this is a good idea.
I think it's not a good idea. I'm willing really? To give it a shot, at least for an episode. I think it's just like, I grew up on Bel Air. It was probably the Fresh Prince of Bel Air. It was probably the biggest show for me, like as a kid. Like would watch it every week, just like constantly on replay. And like, I don't like reboots or reimaginations of a series. I usually think it's really lazy and like, I wish they would just like make it its own thing. But the fact that Will Smith is behind it is like giving me some excitement. Like, I feel like if he wasn't a part of it at all, it would make me a little nervous. I don't know. I've never been into reimaginations, but again, really? Like I'm willing to give it a shot.
What about 22 Jump Street?
See, or that's
21 Jump Street.
That's interesting. Cause like I have never seen the originals. So
they're very different.
Like, yeah. So like I heard,
night and day, yeah,
I heard there was more of like a cop drama.
Yeah.
Before, right. Yeah. So like I love 21 and 22 Jump Street. So like, I guess you've got like kind of a good point there.
So I would say that one of the reasons why these like reimaginings or these reboots happen is because so much time. I don't want to date myself, but it's been almost 30 years since the original show came out. So you have like almost two generations that have passed since the OG show had come out. So I often look at this like I think they're trying to present this story to a new audience. You know what I mean? Whether that works or not, we'll see, right? One of the reasons why I'm concerned is that if you're trying to present this to a new audience, why is the show rated MA, right? That tells me that you're trying to appeal to 18 to, let's say, like 30, 35-year-olds. And so are these, if you're trying to reach out to a new demographic, are these the people that were asking for, you know, a Fresh Prince reboot? So that's kind of my concern.
Yeah, I think I'm somewhere in the middle of you two, where I am a little bit apprehensive, skeptical,
yeah,
but also excited.
Yeah.
And like I keep saying this, I'm always wanting to have an open mind and give things a shot. Because you never know how it's going to pan out.
I try that. That's why I'm going to at least give it an episode. Like, but I don't have my hopes up.
That's fair. That's fair. Will Smith wasn't attached to it, I would be less inclined to have any sort of hope for it being good. But because he's a part of it, like you were saying, Alex, that does help me to feel a little more. I guess that they're going to handle this.
It's in safe hands.
Yeah, I was going to say safe. Yeah, it sounds like it feels like it's more safe. Yeah.
I'm just going to go into it with very, very, very low expectations.
As you should.
And you know what? If you like it, you like it. If you don't, you
just,
don't.
Just a side note, though, this show is doing what I love that big budget studios do, is that it's giving a whole new fresh cast of actors that we've never seen before. I love when TV shows do that. I'm so sick and tired. Alex talked about this really good show called Reservation Dogs. Yeah. That's another example where I think there's only one actor that you've probably seen in like other things, and they always play this like Native American actor anyways. So they often are like often in the background. So I love that, you know, when shows like give a fresh face, you know, I always joke around that Hollywood only knows Michael B. Jordan. That's the only black actor that Hollywood knows. And they're like, can we get Michael B. Jordan in this?
Yeah.
No?
Okay. I remember the days though where I didn't remember him. Like Friday Night Lights when he was like in the reboot season that wasn't like as good.
Yeah. I mean, he was also in The Wire. if you remember that too.
I did not know that.
Yeah, he was in The Wire. He played Wallace in The Wire. So, so that's just to say that, like, I love that, like, you know, actors like Lee Majors, who I think is a great actor. He's in the MCU. He plays the new villain. I can't think of his name right now, but he's also in the Cowboy movie I talked about not too long ago. But I think he's a really good actor. So I just love that they're giving a whole new slate of Black actors a fresh shot.
Yeah. And it was King the Conqueror, by the way.
King the Conqueror. Thank you. I was just drawing a blank on his name. But they're giving a fresh slate. I like that. I like saying that.
Yeah, no, I love that too. Because it's like, I think we forget sometimes that all these iconic actors that we know now, like at one point weren't very popular, and like now we're very nostalgic of it because of growing up with these people.
These people.
And I think Hollywood is really bad at giving new people a shot unless if they're already like TikTok famous or something. And
yeah,
So like, you know, maybe the P is where it's at. The P is the willing P. to give everyone a shot.
Shout out to the tip.
Yeah, shout out to the tip.
And in other news,
you know what's not covered on the P is Batgirl.
Oh,
that's HBO. HBO.
Max.
They are doing the Batgirl. I believe it's going to be a movie. And a couple of things about that: there was a on-set mural spotted. They're filming in Glasgow right now.
Okay.
And there was a mural. Looks like Keaton's Batman, but there's also a Robin with them as well in this mural.
Ooh.
So it would appear that Michael Keaton's Batman at some point did have a Robin. There's also speculation that it was Dick Grayson and he's the one that died versus Jason Todd.
That's pretty interesting, because weren't there rumors that Michael Keaton is going to be or either referenced or in the Batman movie, the one that's coming out? If I remember correctly, I remember were rumors that happen. So that would be pretty cool as well.
Yeah. I don't know. Like, we talked about this. DC is playing a very dangerous game with their movies right now.
Yes, they are. I saw the still shot from Batgirl, and all the comments were like, is this on the CW? Everyone's like, no.
You talking about her costume?
Yeah, her costume.
So that's the other thing I was going to talk about.
Is this on the CW?
That's from... The costume is supposed to be taken from the comic Batgirl, I believe, of Burnside, Year One.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And it is supposed to look like a DIY costume because
it's like the first comic. And it's the first movie, I'm assuming. And it's like, right. You know, she's not.
I think she looks great.
Oh, I don't. It's not about the costume.
I just looked it up.
Yeah. It's more about the lighting, in my opinion.
Yeah, the costume's kind of fun.
Yeah.
I just think
the choice of lighting. I guess my only concern is, like, you know, with these low budget shows, they tend to be more about, with these low budget movies, they tend to be more about, I guess a bad way to put this would be like the story, and there's like not enough action, if that makes any sense, because the action is where the big budget stuff comes in. So it's just like a lot of dialogue. I think that's a better way to put it, that there's just a lot of dialogue, and sometimes that can be hard to chew through. So, you know, I feel like with superhero movies, you do need something to break up the dialogue, something more interesting than an awkward fight. I mean, that's why I loved Marvel's run of like Daredevil and
Jessica Jones.
Yeah, and Luke Cage. I love those runs because the action was really visceral, and it didn't even feel low budget either, but like 100%, the action was very visceral. So I hope they can bring that. I hope they can bring that same energy.
Well, and like, that's in contrast to another thing I was going to talk about, the Naomi show.
I'm
curious. Yeah. Do you guys even know who that is?
I don't know who that is. Yeah.
She's a Naomi
from American
character.
Pie.
No, probably not.
Probably not.
No, this Naomi is Black. So,
okay.
And I believe she's a teenager. And
she's a superhero?
She is a superhero, yeah.
Okay.
She's in the current Justice League run, which I'm a little behind on, but her powers are, she's like Superman level powerful, it seems.
Okay.
And she's also adopted. And the first episode came out on the CW last week.
Oh.
I watched most of it.
I didn't even realize the show was out.
I didn't know either.
Never which heard tells of me, it. Yeah, they didn't do a very good job of marketing this. if you guys haven't even heard of it.
I didn't even.
I live in LA and there's billboards everywhere. But to be fair, maybe it was advertised around my block while I had the.
I'm looking at the poster for it. And had Josh not told me that this was a superhero show, I would not even know it's a superhero show.
Maybe that was their goal to like draw people.
I do wonder that. Because she's a teenager, so like, I wonder if it's supposed to just be like a slice of life show.
Yeah,
with kind of like superhero.
Kind of like the what was the original CW Superman show? What was that one called again?
Talking about Lois and Clark?
No. Smallville.
Smallville was pretty great. Thank you,
Jamie. Yeah, Smallville was a great example of that, where it's like a slice of life show, and then oh psych, he's Superman, you know. So
right,
yeah. So maybe it'll be like that. That's interesting. I would have never known about the show if you didn't say something. I think one of the showrunners is it Ava DuVernay. I have a feeling Ava DuVernay. I think Ava DuVernay is part of this, which makes sense that. Which makes a little bit of sense as to why, like, you know, it's like, it feels like there's already like another show that's already out because Hollywood loves Ava DuVernay. So that
would make sense. Also, HBO is just like launching so much content right now.
They have to. That's something we'll talk about next week because I have to do a little more research about it. But HBO Max in a little bit of hot water. Let's just say. As a teaser for next week, almost $2 billion in the hole for this past year.
Oh, jeez. Okay. Yeah, we'll definitely hear more about that.
They've lost 2 billion subscribers already.
Well, HBO just started a brand new shiny office in Culver, like 5 blocks from me, and it is giant and shiny, and it is filled with ads. Which part of me is like, did you guys start an office to get employees in, or did you start this office to advertise next to the highway?
I'll have to do more research on it to get like the exact numbers and stuff like that, but and I said billion, it might be million, but the point is like they've lost a lot of subscribers and it's not looking good.
It's crazy. I just feel like there's so much content coming out and there's so much content returning.
Speaking of returning, I don't know if you guys heard that G4 is back in full swing.
That's like kind of unbelievable to me.
It was shocking. For those who may not know, or may not be old enough, or may not remember, G4 TV was a gamer TV show on cable. So like if you had cable, it was just like one of the, you know, cable television shows. I used to watch it all the time.
Same
it was
here.
A great show.
G4 and Attack of the Show.
Before Let's Plays were a thing, there was G4 TV. So like you would go there to watch like people play games, review games and stuff like that. Attack of the Show.
They had funny sketches too.
Yes, they did have funny sketches. Really funny sketches, actually, now that I think about it. It's just like a different era. Like we're speaking about such a different era of like of television. It's so bizarre to think about the way that they used to show that show. But recently, you know, there's been a lot of, I guess you can say, vitriol on the internet, because when you know, G4, they came back on YouTube, and then they're using YouTube to kind of like launch like the mini shows, just like they used to on TV. And one of the most popular shows was Attack of the Show and X-Play. If you guys remember X-Play,
mm-hmm.
X-Play,
with, Adam Sessler and Morgan Webb,
yes. And so like X-Play was. It was kind of like a little bit of everything. Like they would do like reviews, they would do like gaming news. It was just kind of like a little bit of everything, but they presented it in a really funny way and interesting way. So it was, you know, and it was like every day was a new episode. So they brought this back and they have different hosts now. That's the big thing with G4 TV. They weren't able to retain all of the original hosts. So they brought in like, you know, newer.
That doesn't surprise me because a lot of the initial cast were let go in a very, very messed up way, like without basically any warning.
Without warning.
There's a lot of YouTube videos on that. And like Chris Hardwick was a huge part of G4.
Yes.
He started the Nerdist, and like I feel like the Nerdist is bigger than G4 now.
I couldn't
imagine him coming back.
A lot of people were let go, you know, because the network was trying to, you know, same old story, right? Trying to salvage money. And so they brought in like, you know, newer people, more relevant people on YouTube and Twitch and stuff like that. And one of the people that they brought back is this, I believe, if I remember correctly, she was a announcer for like League of Legends and stuff like that. Her name is Frosk, as far as I know. I'm not familiar with her other than seeing her on the recent G4 clips. But recently she went on a rant on there. They have this segment where they kind of just like rant, like almost like a, like, you know, any one of the hosts can just rant about something. And she started ranting about, she started essentially giving her experience to the audience. You know, a lot of people, like I said, have been giving them a lot of crap because it's not the exact same show we used to watch, blah, blah, blah. And I guess, you know, the internet is, we've talked about bullying on the internet. We talked about people being jerks, but they've made comments that she's not as like attractive as like the previous hosts. And so she went on a rant basically saying that, like, I don't need to appeal to your sexuality in order to do what I do.
Good for her.
It's so surreal because it's like, why does she have to say this in the first place?
Right. Yeah.
And it kind of just goes into like what we talk about, that like
toxic, you know, gamer culture / online bullying.
But yeah. beyond the toxic gamer culture, because look, as a Black person, let me tell you, it is toxic. It is toxic in video games. It really is. I cannot count on my finger how many times I've been called the N-word. I'm not even talking to somebody, right? So it's like that other person, I guess, it doesn't even know that I'm Black. It's insane. So like there is like toxicity on the internet. And like, if any person that denies that, you're probably the person who's a part of the problem. That's the reality of it, right?
Agreed.
So it was just surreal to like, she's having to explain that, like, you know, I mean, people, I'm not going to repeat some of the stuff that she says because I think we're still trying to fight off having to use explicit, the explicit tag. But let's just say she people have said some pretty vile stuff. And like, my rule of thumb is, if you're not going to say it to your mom, and you're not going to say it to your sister, you probably shouldn't say it to another woman. That's all I'm going to say. So people have said some pretty gross stuff, and she had to like kind of just vent her frustration. And then, of course, surprise, surprise, the internet goes, you're entitled, blah, 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 et cetera, et cetera. And like just totally not hearing what she has to say. So it's a little frustrating. I mean, it will blow over. That's how the internet works. But I kind of felt bad for her. I feel like it's just ridiculous that, like, you know, people see someone on the internet and they feel like this person has to fulfill my sexual desires. Otherwise they have no value to me. What a gross way to think.
Yeah. And like, disgusting.
Like full disclaimer, like if me saying that makes you upset, you can hit that pause button and you can like, you could back out. Cause I mean, come find me on our Bandwagon, Twitter or whatever, and say something to me, I'll let you know because that's just gross. If you want to disagree with someone on the internet because you don't agree with something they say, that's fine. But don't be a coward and attack people you don't even know, because you know that they're probably not going to find you. That's weak. So that's all I had to say about that.
Preach.
I mean, that's all there. I 100% agree. Like, we don't want that. We don't support that on the show. If you're one of those people, keep listening if you want, and then tell us you hate us. That's fine. But we think you're gross and you need to grow up.
Yeah.
Also, I'm glad G4 is like doing things differently than like a decade to.
It's got to be completely different. It's got to be completely different people.
The world is different, people.
Right.
since so we were crazy, children. Dude.
So nuts. Yeah. So nuts.
Stuff like this just makes me like, I want to go like all Batman on someone.
Yeah, it's just
like, oh, what'd you say?
It's gross, man.
Speaking of beating people into a bloody pulp, tomorrow the first full trailer of Moon Knight is going to drop.
Whoa! Actually,
when you're listening to this, it'll be Monday, so today the trailer comes out.
I'm excited, but I've never read anything on Moon Knight, so I kind of want to dive into a 2016 run.
I'm actually excited. I've always wanted to get into Moon Knight's story, so I'm pretty excited.
Pause. The current run by Jed McKay.
Yeah.
Is phenomenal. I think there's maybe 8 issues out so far.
Okay.
Go pick it up. It's so good.
Yeah.
So
I'll look into it.
I've always found that the whole dynamic of like what Moon Knight is so fascinating. To me, I feel like it does, like, it's like a modernized version of the Dr. Jekyll, Mr. Hyde thing. So I think that's cool.
I believe he has 3 personalities.
Oh, so like a split.
Yeah. He has DID, which they... Oh, okay. They use that a little bit in this series, which I love. I love when comics talk about like real world issues, like mental health and like DID. Like, it's a scary thing. So it's cool that they're highlighting it.
Yeah. I mean, and just like a quick like side note, I have always felt that if you never watched Split, the film by M. Night Shyamalan, I always felt that it was insane that James McAvoy wasn't even nominated for Academy Award for his playing, 16 different people?
I heard he was phenomenal in it, but I still haven't seen it.
Watch it, it makes no sense. If I had to guess, the movie probably came out earlier that year. No, it came out September, so there's no excuse. I will never understand how he wasn't nominated. I'm like, the guy, like, the scenes that he's, like, switching between characters, it's, like, masterclass. That's all I gotta say about that.
Right, it's hard to do one role to like get into character, and he was doing multiple
roles. Sounds impressive
in one shot. It was pretty cool. Cool. So I think it's cool because Moon Knight. I think it's Oscar Isaac is Moon Knight. Yep. He's a great actor.
Phenomenal. That's why
I'm excited. Yeah. So that I can't wait for that. It's gonna be great.
And he's Guatemalan. So
yeah,
that's awesome.
Yeah, that's what's up. Alex, what you got for us, man?
Yeah, so before I jump into this, I actually switched what I wanted to talk about last minute. I was initially going to talk about the movie Pig with Nicolas Cage, which came out last year, and I just want to give that movie a shout out.
We could talk about it next week, though. Because I liked it. I liked it a lot.
We'll talk about it next week. Just keep that in the back of your mind, people. Pig.
Yeah.
Or pigs, whatever you want. I switched it out this week because I just picked up a fresh copy of What's the Furthest Place From Here, issue 3. And for anyone who's listened to past episodes, I've talked about this series a good amount. And this issue was the best one to come out so far.
Ooh.
I just think like the world building in this series is very, very, very slow. They throw out or they introduce tons and tons of characters. They have you in this world where like you don't really know what any of the things are. You don't know what the strangers are. You don't know like what happened to this world, how it is. You don't really understand like the motives to everyone. And I feel like this was the first issue where I'm like starting to get like a true introduction to like how like dark this world is. I feel like it's going more into just like a straight up like horror comic. Mm-hmm. And I'm really excited for it. It was just like one of those issues where like I noticed it was pretty bulky and had a lot of content and I wasn't going to read it all right away, but I just like sped read this entire thing. Josh, you picked up on it too, right?
Yep, I'm loving the series, and I'm so glad that you decided to talk about it when you did issue 1. I had no intention of reading this series until you had mentioned it, that you were going to cover it on the show. And dude, it's one of my favorite series so far.
Dang.
Yeah,
it's a lot of fun.
It's cool
because it's so like, weird, but it's good.
Yeah, like the twists are so strange. Like there's all these different like families, and it's kind of like these like gatherings of people that have like almost like these like safe houses, it seems, but every like family has like its own like interesting look to it. And there was like this new family that basically like all the main characters end up at like this hideout house, and they don't know that there's another group of people there. And I'm blanking on the guy's name, Pruffrock. The names are so strange, but like Pruffrock ends up in this room and these people come out. And they look like kind of like demented elderly people. And they're like filming him and like saying all this weird stuff. And he just like freaks out and he's basically just like, you know, like back the hell up, like do not come near me. And they keep like going towards him. So he just like straight up punches one of them in the face. And like one of his other like friends comes out, Marky, and she's just like, you just punched an old person in the face. And he's like, I told them not to come at me. And they're like, but we're in their home. Like, we didn't know they were here.
And yeah, dude, that part had me laughing.
Yeah, it was just so hilarious because it's just like, he kind of was in the right, but like, they end up, like twisting it where it's just like, yeah, you can't just like go around beating up elderly people. But they end up like showing, like, apparently in this universe, we don't know why, but like there isn't any elderlies, or at least there hasn't been any in a long time.
There's no adults at all.
Yeah. So it's all like kids and teenagers, right?
Right. Yeah. Man.
What if it's in someone's mind? That'd be so frustrating if this whole thing was just like.
Nah. If you read it, like you can tell.
Okay.
But, well, real quick, Alex, something I just thought about, because you mentioned how the names are really weird.
Yeah.
It kind of reminds me of The Outsiders with like Pony Boy and Soda Pop.
Two-Bit.
Mm.
Yeah.
Yeah. And also like the dynamics where it's like all these little gangs.
Yeah.
And, it like, is definitely like an Outsiders influence now that you say that.
Yeah. Yeah, I just thought about that now.
Yeah. Well, it's such a cool, like, it's just such a cool series. And I love that, like, these elderly people end up like, he's like pointing out, he's like, no, they're like, he's like, can't you guys see? These are just like young people, like dressed up as elderlies. And he's like, that one clearly looks like a 5-year old. And like, they finally like take like their masks off. Yeah. They're like little kids, like with funny. Like, I don't know, like stilts or something.
And, like dentures and wigs.
Yeah. So they like, they just like go through all these like bizarre like things in the house. Like, for like a quick recap, and like the first two issues, like this character, well, in the first issue, Sid, she's the one that like went missing. She's pregnant. And like, that's the reason they're out here, is they've just been like looking for her. And like, Prufrock finds like a tape in the house, and it's called Sid Comes to Visit. And it's like a recording of like Sid in this room, like being asked all this like weird stuff from, the elderly family. And it's just so bizarre, because like, she's not here, there's no explanation to why she was there or where she is now. Yeah. Or if she's alive. I'm assuming that she's alive, because I feel like that's probably what like keeps the comic issues driven forward. Josh, what do you think? Do you think she's alive?
No,
or think
she's dead? Definitely alive, for sure.
Yeah.
See, now the twist is going to be that she's dead.
Honestly, I think that would be sloppy writing. And is it Matthew Rosenberg is the writer on this, right?
Yeah.
He's been having solid Tyler writing Boss. On this. Tyler Boss. Yeah, no, the writing's been solid on this. I don't think they would kill her off like that. I feel like it's gonna, like her, she's pregnant, so I feel like that whole situation's gonna play off in the end.
Yeah, it's just so cool. Like, Josh, what was your opinion on like the twist with the elderly family when Layla and Marky decide to like stay back?
Dude, the group's gonna head out to keep looking for Sid, and two of the characters stay back. And if you're squeamish, cover your ears for like 10 seconds.
Oh my gosh.
Oh no.
So this is called the Bold Folks Home instead of Old Folks Home. And what they do is, like I said, they're all wearing dentures. They pull out your teeth and then give you dentures. You see them like start to pull out the two people who stayed behind. They like pull out their teeth and then give them dentures. Oh, dude, yeah.
And then it shows a quick recap of like them sitting in the chair, like tied down, and you can like see their like real teeth like on their lap, and it's so disgusting. Oh, and I was like, this is getting so creepy. And like the shots leading up to it are like terrifying. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, there's some really like classic horror panels in this that are done so well.
I'm glad I got twisted, because like before that happened, when they stayed back, I thought it was going to be kind of like, you see this in a lot of like video games like Fallout or like Outer Worlds. They've seen it in, it was in multiple movies. It's always like the twist of like, oh, it's like the older people that are like running a safe house, like, and they turn out to be cannibals. And I was like, right, if they turn out to be cannibals, I'm going to be really annoyed, because like, I just feel like it's overdone.
That's what I thought was going to happen. Yeah. I was like, oh, here come the cannibals.
Even though Texas Chainsaw is still terrifying with cannibals.
Oh, the original one. Yes. Yeah. It's like, ugh.
So gross.
Yeah, man.
But I'm glad they didn't do that twist. But I just was not seeing that coming when they left. And like, the rest of the characters basically are ran by, like, they're led by Mallory and Prufrock, and there's like probably at least like 15 of them that are part of their like little gang like running out. But they're like leaving at nighttime, which is like supposedly like a dangerous thing to do in this world, because of the strangers. And they'd accidentally, like, I'd forgotten to mention it, but they'd accidentally just like killed one. and we don't really know what the consequences of this yet are, but like this is like kind of like the ending of it is making me just like wonder like what the heck is going to happen in issue 4.
Yeah.
And like with the whole thing with the killing the stranger, why didn't they like take the mask thing off to see like what it looks like underneath?
Yeah.
They wear like these weird, it reminds me of like, I don't know, like Silent Hill, like these weird like head wrap things.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And so they accidentally, they kill one. I'm like, why don't you take it off to see what it is?
Yeah.
But yeah.
Well, maybe they will. Maybe they will. Next.
No, they took, they left. They took off.
Yeah. They ran off.
Dang.
But maybe the bold folks home will reveal it. I don't know.
I don't think so, because then the other stranger showed up, which was really creepy.
Did you see their like fingers? Bodies.
Yeah.
Yeah, their fingers look terrifying.
Yeah.
And
then do you want to tell the folks where the gang is going to end up next?
Yeah, so like they basically run into like carnies, but they all look super crooked and creepy as hell. I mean, every carny looks crooked.
Every carny,
but,
yeah, that's a carny.
So,
carnival. Yeah.
Yeah. So I'm guessing issue 4 is going to take place at a creepy, twisted carnival, which I'm excited for.
Dang.
Definitely check it out if you're into horror and weird suspense with a lot of punk music.
That sounds good.
Yeah. Yeah.
How many issues are part of this run?
I think there's going to be 5 total, We're at issue 3. They do reference some more vinyl again in this one. I couldn't see the art perfectly in some of them, but they did pull out a Dead Kennedys record, which I thought was cool.
I saw that. Yeah.
Nice. Could you catch what the other two were?
No, that was I couldn't really recognize.
Yeah. If any listeners know, like. Yeah, they show three vinyl at one point, and like that would be really cool to find out which ones they are.
Nope.
What'd you got for us, AJ?
Oh man, I watched The Eternals, guys.
Let's go.
Yeah, I didn't want to watch it in theaters because honestly, I had low expectations for it. It didn't seem interesting.
I still have low expectations for it, even though I love the director because I love Nomadland.
So that's the thing. I actually enjoyed this a lot. I thought it was a different, very different type of MCU film. I think of the MCU films that we've seen and watched, I think this one was trying to be more like a movie that just so happens to take place in the MCU as opposed to just like a run of the mill, you know, insert here MCU film. I would say a movie like that would be like something like Captain Marvel or Black Widow, where it's kind of just like insert here. Here's a movie, and there's not much to say. If you don't know, basically this movie is about the Eternals and their place on Earth. The Eternals are these extraterrestrial beings. You said you didn't get a chance to watch it, Alex.
I decided to not watch it this week.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. It's okay. No, I just didn't want to ruin. No, too
it's
much.
It's all right. I honestly wasn't planning to watch this one, but depending on how you describe it, I might jump into it.
Okay, so these extraterrestrial beings come to Earth, and almost like an homage to the film 2001: A Space Odyssey, which is one of my favorite movies of all time. 2001: A Space Odyssey.
That's Kubrick, if you remember, right?
Yeah, Stanley Kubrick, one of the greatest directors of all time. In the beginning of the film, the space device, the monolith, right, essentially ushers in a new era of man. So the Eternals are essentially that next wave to push mankind to, you know, embrace technology and stuff like that. So they are there on Earth at least what we're told throughout the movie, that they are there on Earth to assist mankind, you know, to enter the rest of the universe, I guess. And so the film specifically is about two of the Eternals, Cersei. She is an Eternal. Her powers, each of the Eternals, by the way, have their own like cool powers. It was very X-Men like. So like, Cersei had the ability to, from my understanding, like manipulate things from like a molecular level. So she was able to like change like the a stone to sand or something like that, or like water to whatever. And she is one of the Eternals who, you know, they all have their role. Her role isn't really made prominent as much as the, I guess, the other main character, who is Icarus. This is Robb Stark from Game of Thrones. I think his name is Richard Madden. He plays Icarus. Icarus is like, for all intents and purposes, Icarus is Superman. He can fly. He's got literal laser beams. I think he has, like, I don't want to say super speed, because there's already another Eternal that with super speed, but he's very fast for some reason. And like kind of super strength. They really don't define his powers, but for all intents and purposes, he is Superman. So like,
these characters don't sound very unique to me.
So that's the thing. So I'll get into a little bit more, but basically the plot is essentially that, their leader Ajax dies. And so they have to essentially come back together.
Wait, because, Ajax, like the dishwasher soap.
Hilariously, yes.
Yeah, I'm just bringing in the Deadpool reference.
Hilariously, yes, exactly, like the dishwasher soap. So Ajax is essentially like their leader. She tells them what to do. Her powers, she can like heal, but she also has a very specific power because she's the leader. She can communicate to like their leader. Their leader is a celestial. You know, they're sent to Earth. They're sent to Earth by this celestial. I can't remember the celestial's name, but they're sent to Earth by a celestial in order to do whatever they have to do. So they are taking orders from her. Icarus, he's the leader. He's like, okay, because, you know, he's the strongest, whatever. And then you have like cool characters like Thena, played by Angelina Jolie. I thought she did great. And Festus, played by the actor from Atlanta. So like, you know, they all kind of have their roles. They're all like helping mankind. And then one day they all kind of like, their role into helping mankind is no longer necessary, right? They're sent to Earth to defeat the, they're sent to Earth to defeat the Josh, do you remember what they're called in the movie?
Deviants. And Deviants. Then the celestial was named Arishem.
Arishem, thank you. Yes,
is it's from Hebrew.
Is it?
Yeah.
Which, oh, that's cool.
It makes sense because it's supposed to be like this all powerful deity type of thing.
Well, so much of the Eternals is like based on like so many different like mythologies, like Roman mythology, right. Greek mythology, Hindu mythology, like Judeo-Christian mythology. So that makes sense. So the Eternals are sent to Earth to fight deviants. And essentially, once all the deviants are dead, they're like, all right, well, we just have to wait for our cue to, you know, finish up, but they don't really know what that is. And so throughout the movie, you know, you're kind of seeing like it takes place in both the present and the past, and you kind of see like the relationships that they all have with each other. It's a layered movie. Let me just put it to you that way. It's a very layered movie. It's a very, I don't want to say complicated, but the movie is more about the relationships that the Eternals have with each other and them understanding what humanity means within themselves, which is interesting because the spoiler, since Alex walked away, but you know, the spoiler is essentially that they're not human or celestial beings. They're technically robots, really. They're just super advanced artificial intelligence. And when they learn this, this is like groundbreaking to them. They learn that their mission is not to help mankind, but to make sure mankind is grows enough for a celestial being to freaking rip out of the Earth. Like literally, this celestial being will destroy Earth by emerging from it. I don't know if you guys ever seen the show Final Space. It was a very good show. I was very, very sad it got canceled, but it was like exactly like that. Like these seeds are put into different planets. Okay. And then the celestials harvest the life on the planet to then make a new celestial. And then that new celestial creates more galaxies and more planets. And like it's this endless cycle. So the Eternals, they learn that's their purpose. They're, for all intents and purposes, they're farmers, basically. They're space farmers.
Yeah. Cattle farmers.
They're to herd the cattle for the feast. And so throughout the movie, Cersei, she's come to learn that she has a love for mankind. You know what I mean? The mankind. I thought the most interesting thing in the movie was that you learned that the deviants are no longer were also created by the celestial because you know, they were like really effective. But the downside to them, or the flaw in their programming, is that they evolve. So like they evolved and like were choosing to do what they wanted to do, and they weren't being obedient. So I don't remember the celestial's name. Josh remembers it.
Arishem
creates the Eternals as a way to basically create this artificial intelligence that will not evolve, and then theoretically they will not disobey. So throughout the movie, what you're seeing is that it didn't work, right? Because they're learning things like love. They're learning things like anger. You know, they're getting these emotions that they're learning from humans, and in that way, they're evolving on like a micro level, if you want to say. You know what I mean? So, I thought it was interesting. I thought there were a lot of missed opportunities in the movie, though. I thought like one of the things that made the movie kind of feel like it didn't mean anything was that I would have liked it if almost like a Forrest Gump type of thing, if they had shown that the deviants had like a stronger hand in the current creation of mankind, if that makes any sense. It was something that's alluded to, but
the deviants
don't really,
the Eternals.
The Eternals. But also that brings me to my next point. I think it was kind of a mistake the way they used the deviants. They were kind of just thrown in there. I kind of wish they took a page out of Assassin's Creed. And I kind of wish that like they would have done like the Templar and Assassin thing, or deviants are like the bad people in history, right? Like your like your Hitler or something like that. Like the deviants are these bad people in humanity, and then like the Eternals would be these people who help, you know, the quote unquote good guys, right? But in reality, neither of them are really good guys. They're all just using people for pawns, right? So like for example, in Assassin's Creed Odyssey, they explain that like what we know as Greek mythology, like the Minotaur or Medusa, you know, that was just a result of like alien technology. And I thought that would have been a really cool thing to include in the movie. Oh, like 100%, you could have had a really cool scene with like Thena fighting a Minotaur, but the Minotaur is a deviant. Like, come on, that's crazy.
That scene would have written itself.
It would have written itself.
That sounds like the coolest scene ever.
Yeah. Right. I will say, though, to give the movie credit, I actually really enjoyed the action scenes. They were really good.
Yes.
They were really compelling, and they were choreographed excellently. Like, it was really good.
That was probably one of the best things, like not having a CGI orgy fest.
Like it really did a really good job, with the exception of Sprite, who can, you know, she's kind of like Loki, like she can make fake images and stuff like that, and like be invisible. But with the exception of Sprite, I thought everyone's powers was always put in like on display, and that's where it kind of brings like the X-Men parallels. But at the same time, I kind of felt that like the movie didn't really say anything. I thought like a really wasted opportunity was that you had all these characters derived from various, like, you know, Gilgamesh has, I think there's actually like a series of poems called the Epic of Gilgamesh, right? That's who that character is taken from. So I'm like, why didn't they kind of like embrace the origins of these characters? That's a missed opportunity.
It sounds like too many people are introduced, perhaps into one film.
That's one of the drawbacks of this, was that I feel like it could have been two movies or like a miniseries.
It should have been a TV show.
Right.
And it would have been an incredible TV show, even if it was a miniseries. Yeah, even if it was like a miniseries, it would have been really good, because I think the biggest thing that I think probably why most people didn't enjoy the film too much is I didn't buy, it's a love story between Cersei and Icarus. Their relationship was the least believable relationship. You know what I mean? Like their relationship, like I didn't feel like they loved each other, you know, not to transition our podcast to like a relationship podcast, but I always define that loving someone does require some level of sacrifice. Right. And I just don't feel like, I don't feel like Icarus sacrificed anything. Like, like he's met with the choice to either kill Cersei or fulfill his duty to this person, that this being that he doesn't even know, right? And he's, at the end of the day, he chooses not to kill her. But I'm like, that's not a sacrifice. That's a pretty extreme sacrifice. Like, the only way I can show you I love you is not by murdering you. That's wild. That's true love. And then the movie does what I hate movies do, is that they don't know how to like show that these characters love each other. So they just show them having sex. I hate that so much. That's such, like, I don't want to use the word lazy, but it is a shortcut that is unnecessary. You can have sex with somebody and not love them. Okay. So like, that's not showing me that they're in love. And so that, again, another missed opportunity. I'm totally okay if it's a love story, but right, I kind of just feel like, make that love story believable, because I felt like Gilgamesh and Thena's relationship was so much more believable. I felt that
was beautiful.
Yeah. Like, that moment that they had in the forest, I thought that was just that I don't understand why that wasn't written for Cersei and Icarus, the main characters. Yeah. I thought that was really crazy. Festus and his husband, I felt like that moment where Festus' husband is telling him, like, you have to do this because it's your responsibility. Like, that's a moment where I'm like, these people have more chemistry than the main characters. And I think that was the problem. Every other relationship in the movie felt more sincere and genuine than the main character. So it just wasn't believable that, like, oh, he's just going to stop now because he loves her, because we don't know why he loves her. And I think that's even funnier because they've been alive for, what, 7,000 years? So I'm like, you couldn't choose different eras? I'm like, you could have borrowed from so many other movies to do that.
And, like, they could have used, like, other classic love stories to, like,
incorporate
it. Yeah. Gilgamesh from Mesopotamia, them from Greek mythology.
Yes.
This is where having a limit, like, a miniseries or multiple movies would have come in handy.
Yeah.
You could, like, see them, like, in their era where they were most famous.
Yes.
And then you'd feel a lot more anchored, like a lot more attached to the character.
That's a really good way to put it. That there was this missed opportunities to make you feel anchored. The, believe it or not, Alex, I don't think the amount of characters in the show was a problem, or in the movie was a problem. The movie's pretty long. It's like 2.5 hours.
Yeah,
so I don't think that was really a problem. I think they used everyone's screen time pretty well, minus Jon Snow. I thought he was in the movie way too much, in my personal opinion. But whatever. Like, you know, they use these characters, I think, very effectively. I just felt like the writing was just, I don't know, it was just strange that the main characters had the least amount of connection or chemistry. That was probably the most bizarre thing.
Yeah, that seems very odd to me.
Yeah, so, but with that aside, I still enjoyed the movie. It was an easy 2.5 hours. Like I said, the action scenes are great. The movie is filmed beautifully, by the way. The cinematography is like A++.
Well, for, I mean, an MCU going from movie, Nomadland to this, like, I would figure it would look beautiful.
Yeah,
Nomadland is like one of the most gorgeous films I'd seen in the past couple of years.
The use of color in this movie, I thought, was done very well. It's just very authentic. Nothing was loud, and I felt like that fit the tone of the movie very well. My biggest complaints was that the love story was like the worst love story ever, and the deviants were just really put in there because someone's like, this is a Marvel movie, make it more Marvel. And then she's like, okay. So that's the only two takeaways from like the movie that I said, like, that's probably why more people didn't like it. In this movie, there's a great movie. They just messed up. They messed up a little bit.
We can't be winners at everything.
I can't.
Right. It's still worth seeing, though.
Except AJ, apparently. Yeah, maybe I'll get around to watching it at some point just so I can have an opinion on it.
Yeah, you should. I think it's good.
But speaking about some other swings and a miss, did you guys watch the latest episode of The Book of Boba?
Yeah, I just caught up.
Power Rangers.
I hadn't seen either episode. I hadn't seen any episodes, so I watched all of them last week.
Oh, okay.
I was giving this show so much support. I was loving it, telling people to watch it. This third episode, it felt very much like the prequel trilogies, where just like it feels like a little corny and cheesy. And I have to remind myself, George Lucas intended Star Wars to be for kids, but it still felt like they were trying to appeal to adults with the first two episodes. And yeah, this is the first time on the show I've talked about something I do not like. So we'll see how this
goes.
That's
a big moment. Wow.
It is. This is a big moment for me. And so we start out. Episode is Boba Fett is trying to manage his empire. He took over Jabba's empire. And one of the first things he runs into is this water distributor, which is crazy to pay for water on Tatooine.
Also, side note, that actor plays Bill from King of the Hill. Yeah.
And you know who else is? I
have not known that.
What's up?
He's in Barry.
That's right. Whatever the guy's name is. That's right. I forgot.
That's what I recognized him from. Because yes, Barry, if you have not seen Barry, phenomenal show.
Such a good show.
Not for the faint of heart.
When is season three coming out? That's the real question.
I know, right?
Bill Hader, where are you at?
Yeah, seriously.
Get him on the podcast.
You know what? Yeah, we'll make that happen.
Jamie, make some calls, please. Thank you.
Jamie, your job is on the line if you don't make this happen. Just FYI. But yeah, so Boba Fett starts out, he meets these like greaser biker gang kids who drive these Vespa looking speeder bikes, very colorful and bright. Made me think of American Graffiti. I was like, oh, like George Lucas, American Graffiti, like homage to that. Great, but it felt corny.
Yeah.
And I was not a fan. I did like the character designs, like the guy had the weird eye and the one girl looked like she worked at Hot Topic or something.
Yeah.
Like I like the designs. I just did not like their Vespa looking speeder bikes. And then crazy scene that a lot of people probably loved, except for me. There's an assassination attempt by Cranston, the Wookiee. Scary, scary looking Wookiee. Mm-hmm. And my whole issue with that was this dude is 1v1ing a Wookiee, where in the original trilogy, George Lucas told us these things can rip your arms out of your sockets.
Right.
So it was a cool fight scene, but to me, that quote was playing in my head. So I was like, this doesn't feel realistic to the lore of Star Wars.
Right.
Star Wars in itself is not realistic. I get that. But a story has to feel, it has to buy into its own lore for me to buy into it. Mm-hmm. So for me, it just didn't pan out. And yeah, the Wookiee bounty hunter, he ends up getting captured and then Boba Fett kind of just lets him go. Felt like a waste to me.
Yeah, that was kind of weird because even as I forgot his partner's name, but she was just like, are you sure about that? That doesn't seem like a good idea. And he's kind of just like, whatever. Like, I already did
right.
it.
I feel like it's going to be a Billy Madison moment at the end of the series when, like, if you remember Billy Madison at the end, the guy he apologized to shoots the person. He's like, man, I'm God, I called that guy. I have a feeling that's gonna happen.
But
like,
he's crossing off with the makeup.
I have a feeling that's gonna happen. We're gonna see this Wookiee like fly in from out of nowhere and save Boba Fett's life. I have a feeling that's gonna happen.
Yeah, that's I hope that's not the case. That to me would feel like a little bit of lazy writing. And based on the first two episodes, I don't feel like the writers have been particularly lazy. So I want to give them the benefit of the doubt on that. And then, the bounty hunter takes off. And then after that, because of that, the Hutts have shown up. That's why Boba Fett lets the guy go. Because the Hutts sent him to kill Boba Fett. He's like, hey, you sent this guy to kill me. The Hutts are like, yeah, we're sorry. Like, literally, they're like, we're sorry. What? and to show they're sorry, they give him a Rancor, which the... Rancor Keeper is Danny Trejo, which I thought was cool.
Awesome.
Yeah.
That was probably one of my favorite parts of the episode.
And the Rancor, the internet is theorizing it's the same one from The Bad Batch, but you have to watch The Bad Batch to know why. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I will have to watch that. And if you're listening, you haven't watched it, we'll have to all watch it together.
Animated, right?
Yes, right, it's the animated show. Yeah.
And what was interesting about that is Danny Trejo like looks like the scary, like he will stab you kind of guy. But I feel like he plays really well the role of like, I'm actually really tenderhearted because he tells Boba Fett that Rancors are actually very loving creatures and that they wear blinders and that they'll imprint on the first human they see.
I hated that whole scene so
much. I felt like that was so weird because like,
I thought it was funny.
Why has that never been shown in like Star Wars?
Yes. So you want me to believe that Boba Fett had, because remember, if I remember correctly, Danny Trejo's character said that it imprints on the first human. I believe that's what he said.
That is what he said too.
So Boba Fett had a Rancor trainer, or excuse me, not Boba Fett. Jabba the Hutt had a Rancor trainer underneath his palace, and they were friends, and that's how he kept it in line. Like, that's
that. Well, do you remember that the guy was crying when Luke killed the Rancor? You remember that?
That's a good point. That is a good point.
He's very, yeah, very sad. And like, it's been talked about like in comics and books too, like little things here and there.
It felt too much like Pokemon to me, man. I'm like, ah, oh, come on, dude.
To me, actually, what it felt like was a pit bull. Like, pit bulls are actually really loving
dogs. Yes, they are.
People use them for fighting and for protection and stuff like that.
That's a good point.
That's what it made me think of.
That's a good point. That's a really good point. Mm. I didn't think about that.
Yeah, I wouldn't have thought.
Is it ridiculous? Yeah, but that is like what it made me think of. To reason it for it to work.
I just didn't like how much foreshadowing. He's like, Josh, I want to write it. Alex Magosa. And he's like, me. Okay. And then we're going to get a scene at some point of Boba Fett writing a Rancor. Our
theme song is Lush Waves. That's my Taylor.
Well, I like too. He's like, trading starts today. He's like, thanks for listening. We'll see you soon.
Also, are we not going to talk about how the Hutts kind of just sold this dude into slavery? I'm like, what's his salary? Does he get vacation time? The man just shows up. He's like, I'm the Rancor trainer now.
He seems chill. He might be a slave. He's like, yeah, slavery is not that bad for me.
Yeah, I mean, the Hutts are slavers, so like maybe he is a slave.
I was wondering about that too.
And then the episode after that, you have this weird chase where Boba Fett goes to talk to the mayor because he finds out the mayor sold him out. Long speeder chase. They catch the guy and a turf war is coming. So this episode was it was slowly kind of trying to build up to something big is going to be happening. I want to rewind, though, to talk about the thing that I really did not like about this episode. And I haven't seen a lot of other people who have had this take. The Tusken. The Tusken Raiders were all killed.
Yes.
Well, almost all killed, it looked like.
I think it's insinuating they were all killed.
Yeah, I thought they were
all
killed.
You didn't see the Tusken warrior, the woman. You didn't see
her. Fair enough. Body. Yes.
I'm pretty sure she's alive and she'll come back. My issue is, do you guys know what the term fridging means?
Fridging?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
No.
So I believe this was in the 80s. Green Lantern, Kyle Rayner. There's a storyline where there's a serial killer out there, and the serial killer kills Kyle Rayner's girlfriend and stuffs her body into a refrigerator.
Oh my God.
The only purpose of this event was to give Kyle Rayner motivation to like go after this guy.
Go after them.
Yeah. And so like it's a trope. Fridging is a trope where typically a female character is harmed or killed to motivate a male character to some end.
But in this case, it was the kid.
In this case, it was a whole tribe of people were fridged. Yeah. And it felt like such a waste because if you remember, I was saying I was very concerned about this Dances with Wolves trope that they were playing with of outsider comes in and he becomes like the best of us and saves us. So, you know, like Dances with Wolves or The Last Samurai.
I had a different perspective of that whole scene.
Yeah, I didn't see that at all.
Scene, yes, when the Tuskens were killed, I felt like what that was setting up is, if you remember earlier in the episode, I do not remember the race of the fish people. What are they called? What is their gang called or collection called? I call them fish people because it's hilarious.
The Pikes? Was it the Pikes?
The Pikes. I think so. Let's assume it's Pikes. If we're wrong, you can yell at us. I really don't care. But like the Pikes, I felt like what that scene was setting up is that the Pikes did not like that the Tuskens, but specifically Boba Fett, mess with their money. Because I looked at the Pikes like I look at the mafia. And so I felt like that scene when Boba comes to get the collection and he tells them that the other gang is also, you know, to take care of the other gang. I felt like that was almost like a Godfather or like Goodfellas type of scene where you're supposed to insinuate that the Pikes told the other gang the same thing. And so I kind of felt like this was how they eradicated the problem of having to pay a toll to pass through the desert. That's how I looked at that scene. So I looked at it as Boba Fett was just a conduit for this thing that was inevitably going to happen. Because if you remember in the previous episodes, like they were picking him off like stepping on ants. You know what I mean? Like it wasn't, you know what I mean? So I felt like Boba Fett was just an obstacle preventing the inevitable. So I looked at that scene as Boba Fett Boba Fett is used to losing people. You know what I mean? Like, he's used to this because they've shown us this literally in the show when he's a kid. So I felt like it wasn't necessarily meant that he's going to get revenge. I think he will get revenge, but not in the same way I think you and I think he's getting revenge for. Because at the end of the day, I think if there are more Tuskens still available, or still alive, I should say, I think he ultimately he's just trying to give them the leg up they didn't have. I don't think he's intending to be a savior. And I think we know this because in the future, right, or the present, I guess you could say, we don't see them. He's nowhere to be found. We don't even know why he's not with them anymore. So,
which I feel like it's going to show some of that at some point in this series.
Yeah,
that's what I'm hoping.
I don't know why they wouldn't.
This, I'm skeptical.
Yeah,
I think they're gonna do it. I think it was my least favorite episode so far, but I did not dislike it as much as you. I think I was just more kind of neutral with it. It seemed just kind of like a filler episode to me.
Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah,
let me tell you, man. Online, this episode is it's going through the ringer.
The Power Rangers thing had Danielle and I laughing hysterically.
Yeah, I thought it was just funny.
When they pulled up in the multicolor speeders, I was like, yo, look at this. They're about to form Voltron. What is happening?
It was stupid, but I just thought it was hilarious.
I told Danielle, I was like, if they form Voltron, I'm turning off the TV. If these bikes come together and form a giant droid human thing, I'm turning off the TV.
Why not?
Gonna watch this.
I mean, Disney owns Star Wars now. They can do whatever they want. Like,
they can do whatever they want.
Just start adding, just incorporate Pokemon and Star Wars.
Yeah, after the Tusken scene, I kind of just felt like the episode kind of took a nosedive. I agree with Josh that the fight scene was weird. I'm like, this one man is taking on all these people, or this one Wookiee. Like, I get it. Wookiees are strong, and that's what it's trying to convey. But, like, come on. How did he even get in there? How did he get inside? I mean,
they didn't show you for a reason.
They didn't show you because
they don't know how he did it.
They don't know either. Yeah, he teleported inside. I guess you're supposed to insinuate that, like, the Hutts kind of gave him, like, backdoor codes. Just, I don't know. I just thought that was kind of wild. And he's just, like, fighting. And then they drop him in the pit. And then afterwards, like 20 minutes later, he's like, all right, you can leave. He's like, yeah, no hard feelings.
He's like not cool. Injured at all.
Yeah, he's not injured. No one's hurt. Like,
I would like to see the next episode with Boba with just like no arms and legs.
Yeah, I legitimately actually did think though that he was going to lose an arm. I really did think that was going to happen. Because the reason why is because if you remember the water merchant was like, oh, these people infuse their body parts with droid parts. So I legitimately thought that Boba Fett was going to get his arm ripped off. I'm sad that they did not have the cojones to do it. I'm really sad. Because let me tell you, can you imagine him waking up from that dream and getting his arm ripped off? That would have been a top 10 Jeez. Star Wars moment of all time. That's all I got to say.
Yeah.
It would have been top 10 of all time. That would be incredible. Missed opportunity.
I felt a little burned by this episode. A lot of other people did too.
Yeah.
I'm still holding it out for the rest of the series. Jon Favreau has done a lot for us and Dave Filoni.
Yeah.
So I want to give him the benefit of the doubt. And I'm going to finish this series and watch that episode for sure.
Yeah, it's only fair. It wasn't the worst episode. I'm going to finish it too. In terms of tone, it was just weird. It was just like, oh, this is a little Star Wars episode one with the little chase.
I felt like episode like, two.
Yeah, or episode. Yeah, I mean, like the chase through Mos Eisley or wherever they are, is it Mos Eisley or is it?
It's a similar name, but it was
Wherever they are, you know, he's driving around. He's like taking turns. I'm like, man, this scene is taking way too long. Holy cow, dude, this is crazy. Yeah.
So all that to say, I will be watching episode 4. Are you guys going to watch the next one?
Oh, for sure.
All right.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm willing to give it a shot. I just feel like it's just the fact, like you said, like the first two episodes were like great. I'm willing to give it another chance. Like it would have been different if every episode was just okay so far.
Right.
I think that's just part of writing and part of like what we've talked a little bit before is like your first season isn't always going to be your best one. But yes. I think we have such like high expectations with the Star Wars and Disney budgets now. But
Yeah, I mean, they do have a big budget.
See what happens.
They do have a big budget. That's 100% right. I think the reason why people were just let down is that if you're trying to do a setup episode, I think there was probably more you could have added to the episode.
And yeah, totally.
Like the speeder chase thing, that took too long. That took way too long. I would even argue the fight with the Wookiee bounty hunter. That was a kind of a long scene. And then it was met with just the most awkward, like, apology. Like, literally, the Hutts were like, nah, we're good. We're sorry. Here's a Rancor, and we're out. And they leave. I thought that was just weird. That's just such a, yeah. I don't know. All right, we'll see. We'll give them a benefit of doubt.
Yeah, that's all I got on that. What about you guys?
That's it for me.
I'll let you finish, yeah.
Let's get out of here then.
All right.
What do you say?
Let's skedaddle. Is that's that cool, what we're going to start saying now? Skadoodle.
Let's skadoodle. Kids.
Please don't.
All right. On that note, that's it for our show. If you liked what you heard, subscribe so you can stay up to date on all of our content.
What if I didn't like YouTube, what we heard?
If you didn't like it, hit the thumbs down. Please leave a comment. We can see if you thumbs down our video. I want to know why. I want to talk to you.
And don't delete it, you baby. If you're still listening, you know who you are.
You know who you are. We want to talk to you. We want to have a conversation. If you're also on a platform that allows it, you can send a rating as well. Most of you are on Spotify and Apple Podcasts, so those downloads, reviews, and ratings really mean a lot to us. It helps our show to grow. You can find us on Twitter and Instagram at The Bandwagon Fan. We also have Discord on our socials, as well as Facebook and YouTube. You can find episodes wherever you listen to your other favorite podcasts. Thanks for listening. We'll catch you in the next one.
Bandwagon is hosted by Josh Jimenez, Alex Magosa, and me, AJ. Our show is produced and mixed by me, again. Our theme song is Lush Waves by Taylor Lewin of Underscore Audio. Thanks for listening, and we'll see you soon.